Macmillan Audio presents Ridgeline by Michael Punke. Read by Tatanka Means, Amanda Stribling, and Michael Punke. The full story of what happened in that brief hour of bloody carnage at high noon under the wintry sky of December 21st, 1866 will never be known. D. Brown. Key players. Lakota. Crazy Horse, young Oglala warrior. Lone Bear, friend of Crazy Horse. Little Hawk, younger half-brother of Crazy Horse. Red Cloud, Oglala Chief, High Backbone, Minikanju Chief. Soldiers. Colonel Henry Carrington, commanding officer at Fort Phil Kearny. Captain Tenador Tenike, senior artillery officer. Captain William Fetterman, senior infantry officer. Lieutenant George Washington Grummond, junior cavalry officer. Sergeant Augustus Lang, infantryman. Adolf Metzger, bugler. Civilians. Jim Bridger, scout. James Beckworth, scout. Francis Grummond, wife of Lieutenant Grummond. Margaret Carrington, wife of Colonel Carrington. Janie White, laundress. A brief word on tribes. The Oglala and the Minikanju are parts of the broader Lakota family called the Sioux historically by many European Americans. The Lakota, allied at times with the Arapaho and the Cheyenne, broadly divided into Northern Cheyenne and Southern Cheyenne. The Lakota were traditional enemies of the Crow and the Shoshone. December 21st, 1866. Crazy Horse struggled to sort among the flood of sensations, to push away the confusion and the fear, to keep his focus on what he and the other decoys must do. They were close enough now to see the individual clumps of sage that pushed up from the dusting of snow on the ridgeline. In the valley beyond, the great gathering of warriors lay hidden in the gullies and draws, waiting in the frigid cold for the soldiers that the decoys would lead into their trap. He ignored the sudden sound of a cannon from the distant fort. The soldiers probably had spotted a group of scouts sent out to spy from the surrounding hilltops, but the fort's big guns would play no meaningful role today. He focused instead on the scores of soldiers pursuing the decoys, regrouping now after crossing the icy creek. The horse soldiers pushed out in front of the others, spreading out to form a long line, but then, to Crazy Horse's utter dismay, they stopped. The other decoys looked to him. Crazy Horse saw the dismay in their eyes too, and something else that filled him with a mix of great responsibility and dread. He saw that they looked to him for what to do. For a while today, he had felt confident, a confidence augmented by the weekday's vision. After all, as foreseen, hadn't the soldiers taken their bait, riding away from the protection of the fort in the greatest numbers ever? Hadn't the soldiers pursued the decoys to this point, a single ridgeline away from the carefully selected field of battle? But now the soldiers halted. Did they sense the trap beyond? As his mind raced, one lesson from the past 5 months of fighting surged to the fore. His enemy must not be allowed to think, only to react. Raising his war club above his head and filling the valley with his war cry, Crazy Horse charged toward the soldiers' line, the other decoys instantly joining him on both flanks. Crazy Horse looked toward his enemy as the decoys quickly closed the distance that separated the opposing sides. He had fought the soldiers enough times that he recognized some of the officers by their horses, certainly the one who rode the big white stallion. He saw the officer studying them intently before yelling out a command. The horse soldiers fired a volley, though the decoys were still more than 100 yards away. Crazy Horse could hear the bullets streaking around them, but he knew the decoys were beyond the soldiers' effective range. He knew that the soldiers often panicked when confronted with attack, and he knew they now would struggle to reload their clumsy single-shot rifles in their terror of the charging warriors. But then, only moments later, the horse soldiers fired again. Crazy Horse heard the scream of a horse and saw one of the Cheyenne tumble to the ground. Incredulous, he peered ahead toward the horse soldiers, now no more than 70 yards in front of them. He noticed that their rifles today were different, shorter. The soldiers kept the guns to their shoulder and used one hand to operate some sort of lever on the bottom of the rifle, then instantly fired a third round. One of the Arapaho went down. As Crazy Horse watched, the soldiers continued to pour out fire, again and again, without pausing to reload, the smoke from so many rounds already thick around their line. Crazy Horse reined his horse hard, then yelled out to the others, "Fall back!" Sword Owner rode up beside him as they retreated. "When did they get those?" he shouted. Crazy Horse didn't know. He had fought the soldiers led by the officer on the white horse only days earlier, and they had no such weapons then. Now, on this day of all days, he felt his stomach constrict as if he had been kicked. The shots behind them continued as they retreated toward the ridgeline. When they were out of range, he stopped to look back, hoping to find the horse soldiers again in pursuit. A small group clustered around the officer on the white horse in animated discussion, but the line did not move. He stared up at the ridgeline, achingly close. He imagined the hidden warriors on the far side, hearing the shooting and preparing their weapons in anticipation. But for what? Have we come so close only to fail? Part 1. July 12th, 1866. Crazy Horse and the two other young Ogallala covered the last few yards to the ridgeline on their bellies. Horses hobbled for the moment below them on the hillside. They propelled themselves forward with knees and elbows, bows across their forearms, peering through the few clumps of sage and shortgrass that could grow on the dry hilltop. Crazy Horse could smell the dryness and feel the heat rising up from the earth as it breathed beneath him. As the valley below revealed itself, his heart soared, and he forced himself to pause, scanning vigilantly from horizon to horizon, making certain he overlooked no danger. He glanced briefly to his left at Lone Bear, and his friend smiled. Crazy Horse looked to his right at Little Hawk, his brother, still a boy of 13, beaming in excitement and anticipation. Little Hawk spoke in a whisper, "Chechaka na'ish Tatanka, the elk or the buffalo?" It was good to have such a choice. Crazy Horse studied the scene and considered their options. The Shining Mountains formed the far western horizon, their pine-covered flanks a rich green against the bleached late summer grasses of the valley. Water, pure as the heart of the earth, bubbled up from alpine founts and spilled off the mountains, so much that this valley, the valley of the Twin Creeks, held two streams, each cutting a serpentine path through the low ground before eventually flowing together. Thick willow stands spread outward from the water's edge. Moose often fed in such willowy valleys, and as Crazy Horse watched, a big bull lifted his head from the water at a bend in the nearer of the two creeks. Crazy Horse took it as a good sign. He remembered seeing a bull moose on the day, 12 years ago, when High Backbone, his uncle, first brought him to this valley. They had come to hunt then too, and for High Backbone to teach Crazy Horse how to select the best willows for making arrows. They had crawled up to this very ridge, and the scene before them on that day was as it had been on a dozen hunts since, and as it was today. There was a reason their fathers and their grandfathers had fought the Shoshone and the Crow to hunt these lands. Crazy Horse counted the elk, stopping at 50, the animals strung along the creek. He watched the slight bobbing bend of the grass and felt the whisper of a breeze in his face. The nearest elk were only a couple hundred yards down the hillside, including a fat calf that was perfect for their needs. The calf, though, was three times the distance a man could shoot an arrow, and there was little cover between them. If they attempted to creep forward, it was almost certain that one of the elk would spot them and set the herd in flight. He turned his attention to the buffalo. The small herd of 20 or so animals was more distant, a half mile to their right. The buffalo still wore their summer hides, hair mangy and mottled, except where it thickened at the foreleg and shoulder. As snows approached, the hides would grow dense, the rich and heavy robes that kept lodges warm in the coldest nights of winter. They were not hunting for robes today, nor the supply of meat that would sustain the tribe through the long months of winter. The Oglala village was 2 days away on the Tongue River, too far to carry meat in any quantity. Big hunting parties would return to this valley and others like it in the moon of the rutting deer. Crazy Horse, of course, was gathering knowledge that would help him to guide the others when that time arrived. These buffalo, he knew, were a small part of a far greater herd. They had seen the massive swath cut by thousands of animals moving northward, hewing to the grassy foothills and many creeks that tumbled off the eastern side of the Shining Mountains. Crazy Horse always had found his moments of greatest peace in places such as this. Since the time he was barely older than Little Hawk, Crazy Horse had ridden away from the village, gone alone for weeks or even months at a time. His parents had worried at first, as parents always worry, but they came to understand that to be apart from the tribe was a part of their son's spirit. High Backbone advised Crazy Horse's father that such a spirit was a sign of strength. It was obvious that Crazy Horse was different, his skin and hair lighter than the others in his tribe, but such differences should be seen as marks of distinction. When Crazy Horse rode away from the village, explained High Backbone, he was not rejecting his place within the tribe, but rather seeking answers to questions that most people didn't know to pose. When Crazy Horse chose not to be alone, Lone Bear was the person most likely to join him. Of Lone Bear's many attributes, the one Crazy Horse appreciated the most was his quiet steadiness. They could go for hours without talking, both perfectly comfortable, a testament to their bond. When Lone Bear did speak, he had given careful thought to his words, and Crazy Horse knew to listen. "Will we take the elk?" Little Hawk whispered the question, staring expectantly at his brother. Crazy Horse started to upbraid him. Unlike Lone Bear, Little Hawk spoke a lot, even accounting for his youthful enthusiasm and curiosity. His younger brother did not yet appreciate that the best way to learn was to watch, to observe patiently. Then Crazy Horse thought of High Backbone, how the old warrior answered most questions with a question of his own. What will happen if we try? Crazy Horse watched Little Hawk wrestle with the question. It pleased him that his brother paused before answering, and he could see him walk through the hunt in his head. "Probably one of the old cows will see us, or catch our scent before we get close." Crazy Horse nodded, but otherwise let Little Hawk continue to think it through. Little Hawk studied the distant buffalo. Most of the small herd grazed down in the taller grass near the creek, but two calves stood farther up the hillside, close to their mother as she wallowed in a deep bowl just below the ridge. Dust rose from the wallow as she coated herself with the dry earth, smothering the fleas that vexed her in the summer heat. "With the buffalo, we could creep behind the ridgeline until we are close, then ride over, almost on top of them." The younger brother watched for approval in his older brother's reaction, but Crazy Horse remained impassive. Little Hawk took a bit of dust in his fingers and threw it up in the air in front of his face. It drifted back toward him. "The wind favors us." After staring at the buffalo for a few more moments, Crazy Horse nodded again and gave his brother a small smile of encouragement. Then, still on his belly, Crazy Horse pivoted and began to work his way back down the hillside toward the horses. A few moments later, the three Oglala huddled, holding on horseback a short distance below the ridge, out of sight from the three buffalo near the wallow on the opposite side. "When we go fast," Crazy Horse said to his brother. "Pick the closest calf and stay on it. Wait to shoot until you're close, then drive the arrow deep." Little Hawk hesitated. How close when he loosed the arrow? Crazy Horse studied his brother, knowing he knew well the answer. Little Hawk had never killed a buffalo, but in the days since leaving the village, the boy had asked every question imaginable about the hunt, including this one. For an instant, Crazy Horse started to show his frustration, but he paused instead and found himself thinking again about High Backbone, appreciating more and more that, among the many other things he admired about his teacher, the old warrior was patient. Crazy Horse swung his leg over his horse's neck and dropped lightly to the ground. He called the Mustang North Star for the shape of the patch that covered one eye and a part of her forehead. Crazy Horse had stolen the mare from the Shoshone 3 summers ago, and while there were other mounts calmer in battle, he had never ridden a horse with more skill at running buffalo. He stepped toward Little Hawk and handed North Star's braided reins to his brother. "You ride North Star today. She'll show you what to do." Crazy Horse watched the surprise and confidence that came over Little Hawk's face, as if he had been suddenly bestowed a magical power. Every boy in the village coveted the horse, and Little Hawk barely paused before jumping eagerly to the ground, grabbing North Star's mane and scrambling up onto the animal's back. "Hold tight with your knees and let her run," said Crazy Horse. "Set loose your arrow when she tells you the moment has arrived." Crazy Horse mounted Little Hawk's horse. He pulled an arrow from his quiver, quickly checking the fletching before notching it to his bowstring. Little Hawk mimicked his moves, and Lone Bear already was prepared. Without a word, Crazy Horse dug hard at his horse's flanks, and the animal charged over the ridgeline, Little Hawk and Lone Bear on either side. Between the cover of the ridge and the favorable wind, the cow and her calves had barely an instant to react to the charging hunters. The cow, despite her size, was surprisingly agile and fleet. In a heartbeat, she took flight, the 2 calves on her tail. They broke to the right, giving Crazy Horse and Little Hawk the clearest line. As they clambered across the wallow, the musky scent of the cow filled Crazy Horse's nose, and he could taste the dust from the great cloud kicked up as she pounded out her retreat. They came quickly upon a rocky outcropping, and the cow and the larger calf broke even harder to the right to avoid it. Crazy Horse watched in satisfaction as North Star, slightly ahead of him, barreled after the 2 animals, closing the distance but still out of range. The smaller calf stumbled at the outcropping, only slightly, but enough that a gap emerged between it and the other 2. In confusion, the 2nd calf veered away from the cow and toward the creek where the main herd had also retreated. Crazy Horse's pony barreled after the 2nd calf. He could tell from the horse's sure movements that it was well trained, and he knew to trust its instincts, dropping the reins.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.